back and forth inside the lobby. They're saying Kesha lyrics, which, you know, yeah, I guess that shows that they're familiar with each other. we're just waiting for the lobby real quick. We're just waiting for the lobby real quick, and then we're getting on into this game, and well, at least seeing what's going on for drafting. I can tell you, viewers, that the first map is going to be Dragonshire.
Okay, we know that much, but we're just waiting on that Stormcraft link, like you mentioned. There it is.
Okay, there we go. 10-6-1-7, awesome. You know, like, a long time ago, I'd be like, oh man, I can't share that, but I realized, I think, last night in Arena, it's like, doesn't really matter if I share it or not. You can watch it, I guess, in real time or not.
That's the cool thing, yeah. If you want to be a fan, and if you want to watch the draft here, it's going to be a bit delayed.
It'll be 3 minutes delayed, but...
You know what? You can still look at that and you can bookmark that to be like, wow, so that's the order in which they drafted. Very cool. I want to learn from Templestorm and learn how they draft and try to think about that. So it's a really cool thing that you can do. All right. Well, we are getting ready for this game. The draft has not yet started. We are ready.
Yeah, we're ready. We're ready to go. And let's get this set up. And, of course, the winner here is going to go on into Sunday's bracket, which is going to be the beginning of the semifinals. Already we have Cloud9 Maelstrom versus Cloud9 Vortex. How hype.
That's the upper half. But whoever wins here, they will face the winner between Barrel Boys and Lunatic Esports. So, I mean, last time we saw Maelstrom in first, Templestorm in second, and Barrel Boys in third. The potential of it being the same top three is there. But EG, Lunatic, and Vortex, they all have the ability to make those upsets happen.
Most certainly. I mean, Lunatic has just recently been picked up. They were originally Vivid Gaming. And, you know, they've done okay in the past couple of ESLs, but who knows how they can do, because this is a little bit different. That's more of a league where you know exactly who you're going up against. Right. In this type of format, you don't really know who you're... You can, you know, put some guesses, some pins on some people, be like, yeah, we can probably are going to be fighting these people in the future, but... For now, we should basically say we don't really know who we're going to be fighting against. And that's one of those great things about having these smaller tournaments that help out, you know, those types of teams that don't maybe plan so well. But Lunatic, of course, is one of those up-and-comers. And, who was the other one? Lunatic and...
Barrel Boys.
No.
Yeah, well, that's the other matchup happening on the other end.
EG is, you know, just hopefully we'll see them actually come all the way through this bracket and actually get further.
I mean, they're up against Templestorm here. It's time to prove themselves. They've made it. They've been hungry for that big tournament victory, and the draft is about to begin.
And this is where we're going to start seeing some really interesting stuff. So let's jump on over into the draft. Bam! Dragonshire, as we were mentioning before, Evil Genius is taking first pick, first ban.
Okay, this is weird. This is weird. Coming out the bat, instantly banning out Tyranda. EG likes that pick comp. We've been seeing them lean on that Tyranda almost as much as humanly possible, going for the Stitches Lunar Flare or the Diablo Lunar Flare synergy. But no, they don't want to even think about it today.
Yeah, they're going, okay. That's a bit of an interesting decision, though. I mean...
I like it, though. It's confident. It means yeah. Other compositions that they've been working on, they know they don't have to lean on Tyranda, and in fact they don't even want to think about her. They're just like, no, it's too good, get her out.
Just we're gonna take her out of there, and that's a good call. But it's still one of those things we normally don't see in terms of bans, I don't think. So especially for a first ban, Uther gonna get banned out here from Tempo Storm. It's the war of the supports after this point, because now you have to pick up the supports that really matter.
Yeah, opting for that Vala first pick, and I think Templestorm will probably just pick up some damage as well. Hammer, very powerful. Hammer Tassadar could be good. There's Illidan Tassadar, Illidan Rhaegar. There's a lot of really strong options on the table.
This is actually, yeah. I mean, the first drafting from Templestorm, I would assume Sergeant Hammer's not banned. Why not pick up Sergeant Hammer, I would say, as a first? No, actually. Okay. No, I agree with that synergy. Way better. Picking up Rhaegar and Illidan, first picks.
Yeah, it's strong. I mean, possibly the strongest duo in the game. Very, very strong start for both teams. But EG, you know, they have they have those options. So they could pick up that hammer, have those two massive range damage dealers.
And then spend the rest of their three slots dealing with Illidan.
Hell, yeah, it's true. But the damage potential is there. And with Uther being banned out, that's tough for EG. I wonder if we'll see something like Brightwing once again, because the Polymorph worked out in that previous series dealing with the aggression out of Illidan.
Hmm. That is a good call. I think Polymorph and Brightwing would be a really good pickup here for Evil Geniuses. But of course, that... you know, Brightwing is a little less in favor recently. I mean, Polymorph is strong. Okay, Lost Vikings again. Gonna be probably seeing Idra pulling out the Lost Vikings on Dragonshire. We saw that game number one today.
Yeah.
Or was that game two? Game one or game two? First
we've,
set.
We've seen
it
in the series. Few, yeah. Actually.
Well, no, I meant Evil Genius is playing it.
Oh, yes. Yeah, no, Idra's Vikings looks really good too. And like we said, it's no surprise. He's got that micro. He's got more micro training than most gamers, considering he played Brood War and StarCraft 2, and he even played in Korea for a good long time. So we'll see what he's able to do in this game, but there is the AoE damage coming out from that Tassadar, which works quite well against the Vikings.
Yeah, and you know, not only just the AoE from the Tassadar, but also, you know, as soon as Illidan gets level 4, that immolation is going to be great as well.
True, true.
And then to even concatenate on that, they have ETC, who always picks up Echo Petal at level 4. So they're going to have a lot of just kind of this weird passive AoE damage that's going to constantly be taking down the Lost Vikings' health if they ever get into massive engagements against them.
Yeah. I think we're going to see ZP's playing Diablo. It's not...
Nope, Muradin. Oh. I was going to call it. I was going to say, we haven't seen Muradin today, but I think Muradin would be a great pickup for EG. Such a great lockdown for Illidan. You pick up Avatar, you've got the stun hammer, you've got the slow on W. Muradin is a really great way to counter out an Illidan.
It's just ZP's is actually the last remaining Muradin in North America. He is the only player that still will consider running Muradin, it seems. And it's refreshing. It's nice to see. And of course, he will blend in with the Vikings. So there's now four Vikings in some sense.
Or at least four short men with beards.
Close enough, right?
Actually, five men with beards, because look, they also have Malfurion now, too.
He's not short, and he's kind of green and blue, so...
Yeah, that's why I stopped getting rid of the short modifier.
Well, Tempo, they've got their final pick ahead of them. They're going to go for a big damage dealer. Hammer has made it all the way through to the last pick, potentially. But Zeebo, Jaina, there's still plenty of other strong options, and we saw how good Hinterland's Blast was in that last game. You can never count out Falstead.
I'm just trying to decide who could come up with Team Beard. It would be like ETC, Malfurion, Muradin, Lost Vikings, Uther.
Falstead? Did you not say Falstead?
Oh yeah, Falstead.
Oh my gosh.
Falstead would be a great pickup. That'd be actually not a bad team.
Why is Jaina
pretty
not
rounded out?
Jaina's got the nicest beard.
Jaina?
She's got the nicest beard.
Oh, that's just mean.
No. It's not. It's beautiful.
I think we need to go over the definition of a beard for you, Jake. All right, so Tempo Storm, last pick. Thoughts. Rhaegar, they've got their supports handled. They need a ranged assassin.
They could do a blow up. They could grab Sonya. That would be fun. That would be interesting. We saw Kerrigan earlier today. It works in a similar manner, but I do like the idea of Metamorphosis stage dive heroic leap onto whatever you want to blow up, but Malfurion can handle that too relatively well, especially once he has Ice Block.
That is actually a really good point. I don't know.
I don't think we'll see Tychus. They're thinking hard about this because it's tough. Because Hammer would be good, but there's a lot of things that can deal with Hammer too. I mean, they just have... okay.
Tychus. Tychus is a good pickup. I agree with this.
It's interesting.
AoE damage galore.
I'm curious. I guess Odin is a little bit more viable in this matchup when you consider they don't have something like Chen. They don't have the Illidan coming in onto you. And typically if we do see Odin, it's with flanks. And if there's a map where you can flank in a lot of different manners, it's probably Dragonshire when you're fighting, especially in the midpoint of the game.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right. I think Odin would be a good pickup. I mean, we normally see Laser just all the time now, but I think Odin would be a good pickup just for that AoE.
It's just nice to have the option. Like, yeah. they're both fine picks at this point in time.
Though I'm curious at how Laser would do against a boat.
It would probably shred the boat, honestly. It would probably evaporate it, and that might be what they're thinking here.
All right, so we've got the game ready. We're ready to go. We are starting up into game number one. Ladies and gentlemen, if you haven't tweeted out anything today, if you haven't Facebook posted, if you haven't done anything social media, you should probably get out of, you know, whatever crazy place you are in without the internet. But once you get to that place with the internet, and if you have tweeted already, I don't care. I want you to tweet out right now. EG versus Tempo Storm. It's Tempo underscore Storm for some strange reason. On Twitter. I want you to tell everybody on Facebook to come watch these games, because these are going to be some pretty fun games. Even if Tempo Storm walks over this with a 2-0, I still think we're going to see some really awesome strategies, because we're seeing Idra go back into that APM game. Let's swap on over into the main screen.
And speaking of that main screen, well, on the blue side of the map, we have this little group. You might have heard of them. They're called Tempo Storm, and they have Arthalon playing as Tychus Glaurung, Rockin' the Cow, Mr. Elite Torn Chieftain, Soldier, playing Illidan, Tassadar, rockin' that. I don't know if I like the synergy that much. It's nice. It's good attempt KO, but that's gonna be Tassadar and Dread rounding it out on Rhaegar.
Over here on the right-hand side in the red trunks, it is Evil Genius's ZP's playing Muradin as Candy King Muradin. Faye on Zagara, Mad Timmy playing Malfurion, Cawthon, Luck playing Vala, and Idra playing a ragtag group of Vikings going on up into the top lane, trying to body block those creeps as much as possible.
Yeah, they're so ragtag, they're even lost. It's tragic. Tragic. Well, again, we do have the Zagara, and we're going to talk about that creep being very crucial for just that vision throughout this middle section between the middle and bottom lane. But once again, there's a lot of responses available. The Tassadar can just pop the Oracle, and we are going to consistently see the rotation happen for the start of the game.
And this is, you know, some cheeky stuff. I don't think we actually see too many teams really do exactly what Evil Geniuses does with these creeps in bottom and top, bottom and mid. You know, we can already see that Tempo Storm's just like, all right, we're just gonna have like two people in each lane, kind of just deal with this. Evil Geniuses has this ever looming threat from the fact that you can just kind of jump back and forth between these two lanes and then just go to another lane and have four people there, which is really scary.
Very true. Very true. And, you know, especially with like ETC and Illidan dashing forward towards you, the threats are gonna be there. But Dredd sitting on that first watchtower is going to be able to sit there, cap it. Don't think we'll see an early Dragonite in this game, especially with this constant presence in the middle lane out of Evil Geniuses. And they're starting to get that creep spread vision in the middle solidified.
Yeah, and they're doing, you know, a pretty good job of just having everybody where they need to be. There is a little bit of an engagement down here in the bot lane. Soldier taking actually a pretty good amount of damage. Dread not really not getting too many heals on him. ZP's, though, has to be a little bit careful. Does leap out of there. And, you know, this is a really scary mindset to have to be in. Being that lower-seeded team, the team that normally isn't doing so well, going up against one of the higher-ranked teams of the entire NA scene.
You look at most world rankings, Tempo Storm sitting at number one.
Yeah.
They have won more events than any other team in the world, and their actual win-loss ratio is something disgusting. I don't know the exact number, but it's up there.
Yeah.
It's really up there.
I mean, I think in total, I think Dreadnought, I think if I looked at his player profile correctly, has lost like 10 games in Hero League. These guys are just ridiculous. I don't think it's actually there, but it's something really close. Arthalon, though, getting engaged upon pretty hard, does not die!
He was at less than 10 health. That is as close as it gets. It's, oh my goodness, so very, very close. And in the bottom lane, during all that aggression, we see these bruisers being picked up by Soldier and Dreadnought. So going from almost capitalizing on that first blood to, hey, look, they just got mercenary camps that we have to respond to.
Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, mercenary camps are just so great, especially those mercenary camps. If you can get away with those, the other two, you know, on their side, they're easy. They're defensive mercenary camps to pick up. But picking up those ones, those are the only ones that nobody has any real advantage to pick up, and that's just a nice little bit more damage that you can do. Drains out both the towers' damage, tower's ammo as well, so it sets them into a really good position for later aggression if they, well, not really later, but you know, some pretty close to now aggression if they really want to set up before those the ammo starts to regenerate.
Yeah, it definitely does. And speaking of mercs, I mean, Illidan's just keeping on that merc life. He's got the immolation. He's going in, grabbing these bruisers. Now, Zagara does scout him out with roaches, but guess what? Those roaches are only helping him in his cause to defeat the bruisers, and he will be able to pick up that camp. But EG taking advantage of this situation and this knowledge and trying to grab some very early aggressive giants.
They are going to get warded away here by Tempo Storm. Arthalon going to get engaged upon yet again. Is he going to get away with 10 health? I don't think so. He's going to get away with a little bit more than that this time.
Yeah, he's got first aid now, so it makes it a little bit easier to get caught out of position.
Or at least a little less scary to get caught out of position. I don't know if you want to be easily caught out of position.
Fact. Well, but we do see the Vikings being kind of all over the place. Idra just microing them back and forth,
doing
this little dance with Glaurung. But Glaurung gonna find, of course, Eric, forcing that jump out, making him tap the well. But Olaf is able to hold on to the top shrine, and we can see the fight happening here in the bottom lane. They're trying to reclaim both to get that Dragonite.
Yeah, still about 4 minutes, just about to be 5 minutes into the game. No Dragonite has been claimed just yet. ETC is still just constantly being pushed out of here by dealing with these. And oh, first blood going to go down. Vala's going to fall, actually.
Yeah, the grenade just securing that kill. Arthalon and KO just have that damage output, and they pick it up. Glaurung, though, trying to take this, but with three Vikings, it's a peculiar situation. But he is going to be able to turn the shrine over with that knockback.
And actually, Glaurung might be able to get enough time here for Illidan. No Fae at the last second, getting the roaches in. Really nice play coming out here from Evil Geniuses.
Yeah, and Glau just, you know, he has to run away from the Vikings. And he's going to have to hearth home. So now they're going to lose Soak unless, of course, we do have Arthalon making his way up. So he gets there just in time to not lose any Soak, forcing back those Vikings. He has the grenade to dish out the damage both to the wall, minions, and to the Vikings. But ZP has now taken the bottom shrine.
Yeah, and this is really nice rotation here coming out here from Evil Geniuses. They just have to make sure that they don't give up this bottom shrine, because yet again, where they're losing their top shrine again, they need to make sure they get down here, because Tassadar is floating mid. Okay, there we go. Lost Vikings did claim the top shrine yet again. This is a very scary game of map control.
It's magical shrines, my friend. Musical shrines, whatever you want to call it. They're just going to keep trading those places, because what it's all about. And just speaking to the heroics really quick, we do in fact see the laser drill, so no Odin today. Laser drill, which has become the norm, sticking it out. And we do have longboat raid being a very formidable form of damage. So once that big team fight happens, there's a lot on both teams.
Looks like the Tempo Storm is just going to continue to play that bottom lane game, and they've got a good amount of people around here. They don't have too many objectives to really claim out of this bottom lane, though. I mean, as soon as they keep coming down here, there's nothing for them to really take. Sure, they can push down these towers, but there's no siege giants to really take advantage of either. Evil Geniuses has just been sitting in these lanes for so long, they haven't claimed their siege giants yet.
Look at Arth. He's just applying so much damage to these Vikings. Tapping the well, they're still very hurt, but Tassadar has to defend the shrine while Temple Storm does reclaim it in the bottom. And going forward is Soldier, trying to get a lot of damage onto ZPs. There's a big strife hitting three members of Temple Storm, but the chain heal will be enough to keep them alive for now.
Yeah, that's going to be actually a pretty big use of Strafe here, because, I mean, it did a lot of damage. It was able to ward them off temporarily, but she's got to get, I mean, Kofalmog's got to get that Strafe up as soon as possible. It's already down to 37 seconds. Bow momentum just so incredibly strong on Vala. But still, it's, you know, that's going to be a couple of seconds where you don't have the ability to use that Strafe yet again. Dreadnought taking a lot of damage is going to get warded away yet again. Shrine control going back over to Evil Geniuses.
This is just so back and forth, so very close, but there's going to be a slight talent advantage for a little while. Level 13 being achieved by Tempest Storm. So they can use this to try to get the additional damage. We see Lead Rain that applies 20% slow every time Overkill is used. Those Vikings keep barely escaping. That's going to change quite a bit. Glau, though, is very low in the strips going in, forcing out a stage dive just to mitigate damage for a little while. And dashing forward onto ZPs, he can Dwarf Toss over that wall.
Does give them enough time, though, to keep lasting through this fight till they get level 13. Glaurung is doing really good work by just kind of just staying alive for way too long. he looked like he was gonna die. Oh wow, Tassadar does go down. This is a huge amount of map control this is gonna give over to evil geniuses. They could potentially turn this into a shrine very, very shortly. They have to have those lost Vikings run up top. They have to grab that shrine. Tempo Storm is retreating very quickly.
EG, like, they cornered Tassadar with those four bearded grows.
Idris not going to the top shrine.
Vikings the other side and Spin and Wind all hit him at once, and he just got decimated, really.
Oh man, Tempo just got a little bit of a window there because Idris took a little bit of time to get to the shrine, and actually Vala's running away from the shrine. Are they not going for the shrine?
I am not too sure. The bruisers were picked up by Tempo Storm. They probably figured the shrine was forfeit, and Kathan will end up getting it.
Oh no! They had so much time to pick up a Dragon Knight.
Yeah, that's a blunder. In that regard, but Dread taking a lot of damage. EG still, you know, they haven't lost Dragon Knight to Tempo Storm. They just, you know, lost enough time to grab it. So it's not the end of the world.
That's true. They do
have that level advantage, and Olaf does fall. So that's just one of the Vikings.
I'm scared right now.
A lot of pressure in the bottom lane from EG. They're just getting that damage out. Those roaches going in, they're escorting those siege giants, making sure they can maximize the damage, because that's what giants are for, blowing things up. But you can see the melting point working through their health bar so very quickly. That gray marker that you see burns through them. That'll be enough to clean up the second one. But EG, they're responding by grabbing more bruisers here in the bottom of the map. But look at this rotation from Tempo Storm.
Oh, looks like they want to make a fight, at least at the shrine. They don't actually know that this is going to be a fight for the giants, for the bruisers. Arthlon taking a lot of hits, gonna actually go really low, gets shielded, uses first aid. Looks like there is going to be a huge 5v4, really, really nice maul coming out here, getting just enough time for the lost Vikings. Oh my god! The AoE coming out from evil geniuses!
It just, I mean, both Illidan and our ETC player were already pretty low. The Maw just sealing the deal. Those roaches came down, ruining his day. Ancestral does go off on the KO, saving him from that longbow raid, but this fort is forfeit. And guess what? I think that's going to be the first Dragonite of the game.
If they actually go for the Dragonite this time.
True. Well, we'll see.
Can I just say that Evil Geniuses is looking absolutely amazing today?
Yeah, they really are. And they have 16. They have the level advantage. They have the hero advantage. Two heroes down. Kills 3 to 1.25. And, I mean, they're just looking on point. Dread taking a lot of damage. The wolf form will allow him to escape. Just throwing down the healing ward just to be sure. Of course, that slow. And EG, they almost were able to rotate up from the middle lane. But no, spotted more members of Tempo Storm. And guess what? Tempo Storm has managed to hold out from a Dragonite. They weren't able to rotate up quickly enough.
I think the real story here is, look at Kothalmuk's hero damage, 35,000. Oh, Arthlon gonna get caught.
Oh no.
Top shrine gonna go over to evil geniuses. They have to be really careful though. There's a little bit of a window here for Tempo Storm to make a question. No, it looks like that is not gonna happen. They're gonna at least get the top shrine. Can they actually make the, here's my question. Are they actually going for the Dragon Knight at all?
So far, it doesn't seem like it. They're just prioritizing, rotating, and ganking. And it's working out for them pretty well. 16 has been reached by Tempo Storm, but again, Arthlon is now dead, taking that kill count to 4, and just allowing EG to always be in a safe position. They're finally picking up some more Merc camps. Those Bruisers will probably be next on their list, but we see, you know, also the bottom shrine being taken by ZPs.
You know, I've heard a lot of pros at one point or another say that the first couple of Dragon Knights don't really do that much. Maybe Evil Geniuses is really just kind of testing out this theory. And maybe we're getting to this point, at least we're going to say Titan Arena 2. Remember that Titan Arena where nobody actually went for map objectives and they won?
Okay, wait a sec. We do have the stage up and a nice steal onto these Bruisers. So maybe Tempo Storm's catching on and rotating around the map saying, hey, look, they're not going for these camps. Let's put some aggression on, and they're actually going to probably take out this top fort as well.
Oh, it's getting really, really close now. It is going to be a 5v5 here. We have full team stacks down here, but meanwhile, if they lag this out, they've got Siege Giants pushing down that bot lane. Looks like the tower or the fort is just barely going to survive for now. The melting point barely not going to kill it. Very, very close.
Yeah, so close. EG is rotating in. KO in the backline gets hit by all of that damage, but Dimensional Shift will allow him to back on out, getting to safety. Temple Storm has Illidan in the bottom, capping that bottom shrine so that there will be no Dragonite right now, but KO gets hit once again with that Storm Bolt, and the heals will be enough to keep him alive.
They do just buy just enough time to keep that Dragon Shrine alive. They actually had Eric sitting back there trying to pick up that Dragon Shrine right after that huge engagement or disengagement from Tempo Storm. And what was really scary about that is if they got into a massive team fight, they don't have a boat. You have to have all those Vikings nearby or dead to have that boat up.
Right, and Tempo Storm is in the top. They are going to stop another Dragonite once more, and they need to just continue stalling because they did use Archon to survive that last situation for KO. As a result, that's 60 more seconds, another full minute before it's ready. And that's a big advantage for Evil Geniuses.
And it looks like they are going to go respond to the threat of Idra down bot lane. Is this going to be a full turnaround? No, actually, Evil Geniuses looks like they want to catch up Soldier and Glaurung as they're transferring down. This might be a big team fight in the making. I mean, there's a lot of people around here in a very, very small area.
All right, so the thing you have to consider here, though, is Norse Force was in fact used by Idra. That's a minute cooldown. That's his E. And with that on cooldown, Archon will be ready in 30. It's still like a lot of survivability lost on the Vikings. Get it? All right.
Why am I not allowed to pun today?
You're just not. Hindering Moonfire on Malfurion will allow them to continue their chase, and they've been doing a good job locking down. I gotta say, this Muradin has been paying off because those Storm Bolts have really been on point.
Yeah, and actually that's a really cool thing I want to mention real quick, is that normally we see the triple Storm Bolt Storm Bolt talents coming out here from Muradin, but today we're actually seeing Reverberation and then Crowd Control, so he's actually leveling up his W now.
Yeah, it's really just a response to Illidan.
Yeah.
If Illidan is one of their primary forms of damage, Muradin can be a direct counter. Muradin can counter a few heroes like Chen, Illidan, depends on how he builds. He can be a great response to various situations like that.
Temple Storm looks like they want to take a little bit of map control by going for these Siege Giants. Very nice choice here. It's going to deny Evil Geniuses the ability to push down that lane easily later on. Oh, yeah, there we go. Soldier does get caught by the Entangling Roots, but they don't really look like they want to make that into an issue. Actually, maybe they do. ZP's now going in here using his Storm Bolt. Does lag out Soldier. Soldier coming back in here does use his first aid and shield. But ETC coming in, is he a little bit too far forward?
I think he'll be all right if Believe Ancestral is still, in fact, available. Matt Timmy using that ice block. There is the laser drill, and it's going to town on Vikings. But they're doing their best to power through this. Healing Ward healing it up very quickly. Just the end of it reaching, and the laser drill has done its job, helping zone back Idra, who did use Norse Force. Both shrines being controlled by Tempest Storm. That one minion being obnoxious, stopping Dread from being able to cap that. And this game is just so back and forth, and Eric will be trying to cap that top shrine. It's going to be so close with Arthas.
Oh no, he walks him out of it!
He does get it!
He walks him outside of the shrine for a last second!
No. So unfortunate to have that happen, but this is the first Dragonite of the game?
And it's at 16 minutes.
What?
16-minute first dragon. I think this sets a new world record.
It's certainly up there for competitive. Those Mutalisks doing a lot of damage. Arth, he's already lost half of his health bar. The Dragonite has a full minute in duration left, but EG is just applying so much aggression, and without the rest of his team, ETC's not there. Stage Dive still on cooldown. He just pretty much throws it away.
Yeah, level 20. This is really scary, too. Let's take a look at what's going on here. Fury of the Storm being picked up by Zagara. Okay. Ragnarok and Roll coming out here from the Vikings. Hardened Shield. Bolt of the Storm, Bolt of the Storm.
Yeah, so typically on Zagara, we would always see Bolt. But as the meta has shifted and as we have that last patch, Fury is a pretty solid option. That's an additional 200% damage every 5 seconds onto that primary target. So that does add up very quickly. The Strafe is adding up as well, dealing so much damage to the entire team. Ancestral connecting with Soldier. But that Longboat Raid, the level 20 upgrade, hits so hard, forcing out a full-on retreat. And Arthwan needs to be really careful.
But they disengage so beautifully, Jake. This is actually a really bad spot here for Evil Geniuses. They spent two heroics, though so did Tempo Storm.
Yeah.
But, you know what? Actually, I think that's going to be a pretty even trade.
It is rather evening, but you have to consider that Glaurung has no mana, so they have to just fall back. Stage dive is ready, so he can just heal up to full and stage dive in. They're going to look to potentially initiate with that, and that's what we have happening here.
And here comes that massive engagement. Now Faye has to back up here. Soldier going straight on into the middle of Evil Geniuses. They have to focus him down. They have to take him out. ZP's desperately trying to get in there, but Soldier distancing himself long enough. Faye's going to go down. Evil Genius is taking such a great fight, but it's just a little bit too much for them to handle. Glaurung now is going straight on in. Mad Teamy gets zoned. He's going to go down. ZP's trying to desperately give themselves a little bit more spot and space, and he's going to give, you know, at least three people are going to be able to get out of here alive, but they lost two people. Dragon Shines are up in 10 minutes. 10 seconds, sorry.
I mean, EG, they are looking great. Temple Storm finally taking a fighting advantage, and with that, they take the lead. Like you mentioned, those shrines are very close to those death timers, though. 30 and 40 seconds, respectively. I believe Temple will get back-to-back Dragonites and, you know, just try to continue to push that momentum forward.
It's going to go straight on into KO. There's not much that EG's trying to do right now. It looks like there is going to be a slight engagement as Soldier does go for these jungle down bot. Trying to get the jungle camps before the Dragon Knight despawns them. Very, very smart. And now they've got this Dragon Knight as well as all five people up. They still have 10 seconds before we're going to see our Malfurion come back up for Evil Geniuses.
And the difference with this Dragon Knight is they have their entire team pushing with it. The last one, Arthlon just kind of got evaporated. This time, KO can get very aggressive because that's Tassadar underneath. He can get out of almost any situation. And they're going in. They've got that level 20 laser drill. It's shooting from such a far distance, and there is no hope for this keep.
Yeah, that level 20 drill, I mean, look at that giant range on it, and it just does so much damage so quickly.
Yeah, just kind of burning on Mad Timmy, forcing him back. Can it even reach that well? I think it might be able to.
Oh, Idra actually in a really weird position right now. ZP's trying to give him a little bit more space, trying to zone everybody from Tempo Storm in order to keep everybody alive, but it looks like Olaf is going to go down here. Always forget
the mic. Still 20 seconds on this Dragonite, so it got a keep, it got a fort. It's done plenty at this point in time.
Yeah, this Dragonite is definitely one, and he's just going to cancel it. He's just like, all right, we're done here. Gonna hit an R. There's not much we can really do, and just, it's a looming threat, but it's not gonna help us out here. So let's just get back to where we need to be. They're gonna go down bot lane, pick up these bruisers, gonna pick up the siege giants, get a really nice bot lane push, and see what they can do with that bottom map map pressure.
Yeah, the bruisers will be picked up before Muradin is able to dwarf toss his body into there. Just a little bit too little, too late. And again, we've seen EG take massive fights with the power of Maw. Set up that Maw, line up Longboat Raid and Strafe, and just rip through the enemy team. They have to try to do that again.
That was just, I mean, you know, at first I said that was a huge mistrade and Evil Geniuses was really far behind. Then I said it wasn't really so much of a bad trade. Looking back at it, without that boat, they really just can't engage. Like, there's no... I don't think there's a really good way for them to engage without having both.
Yeah, the damage output is almost a necessity when you consider both Tassadar and Rhaegar's healing potential. The sustainability is real. And well, with this bottom keep, I mean, there's just a constant pressure in the bottom lane. Those catapults just keep walking their way on forward, rolling their way forward, applying pressure. In tempo, they're out soaking. They've got ETC in the top lane, stage dive with the global presence.
Yeah, ETC trying to make his way over there without even having to spend that stage dive. Looks like everybody knows where everybody is right now. They're going to have to back up 25 seconds until the next set of shrines. And I really like this. Evil Geniuses playing back. They're not doing anything crazy. They can't lose another Dragon Knight, because if they do, that's going to be game.
Yeah, they're just waiting for a fight in a situation where they're really comfortable. They don't have any urgent reason to take a fight right now. The level 20 advantage, I mean, there's no talent advantage, it's just strictly stats. And as long as they maintain, you know, close to that one level position in the game, they can easily take an even fight.
I really like this from Evil Geniuses as well. They're deciding to push the top lane because that's where the bruisers are. They can also claim the top shrine at the same time and deny that temple from Tempo Storm.
And yeah, looking for that opportunity, but again, ETC abusing his global presence. Glaurung grabbing bottom giants, and that's the lane in which there are already catapults. So this is going to put, I mean, the longer that Temple Storm draws this out, the more advantageous this will become. And we see just some damage being traded out, the heals going off, Oracle revealing their position, and Glamorgan will in fact get those giants. And he's just going to be obnoxious and push on in with it. This is going to force EG to react.
And this is going to be one of those weird moments, because Evil Geniuses is going to lose this top shrine. They've already lost the bottom shrine. Guess what? That's Dragon Knight. That's waiting to happen. They have to get this team fight. They have to win it. Soldier's going to possibly go down. He takes a lot of damage. Bolt back out of here. Here comes an Ancestral to heal him back up. Idra is just waiting for the opportune moment. And here it is. They've wasted their heroics. He's going to use his. Going to use that boat. Going to do as much damage as possible. It's not a ton of damage, though, just yet. Soldier's still a pretty good amount of health. They have to take him down. He's going down so low. ZP's finally going to fall. It looks like this is going to be a really good fight for Tempo Storm here. They're trying to make something happen. And as this is happening, we have Arthlon running down, picking up that Dragon Knight.
Yeah, the healing ward got its entire duration on almost the entire side of Tempo Storm. Just so much healing being done through that. And a lot of low heroes, like we said, the Ancestral was on point with that. And once the Archon got in there and started wailing away on the already weak team of Evil Geniuses, it was lights out.
Oh man, but can they make something happen here? They're waiting for our good friend Soldier to run all the way back up here on his little mount, his little money pig. And he's coming back in here, and as soon as they do, they're going to have that 5v4 advantage with the Dragon Knight. And this is a 24-minute Dragon Knight. They could possibly just completely ignore everything coming out here from Evil Geniuses and go straight for the core. That's exactly what they're doing. It looks like they're going to be successful in taking out Evil Geniuses in game number one.
Really well played by both teams, though. Temple Storm, yeah, going up 1-0, but my goodness, EG is looking better than ever. Like, honestly, I don't think I've seen them play this well before.
I am completely surprised at how well Evil Geniuses is playing right now. I mean, we've seen them do not so well in a lot of tournaments. Already, they've already beaten their previous Titan Arena placing, which I believe was in 9th place. So they're coming up through this bracket. They're doing a really good amount of work here. And they put up a good fight with Tempo Storm. And that's not easy.
No, not at all. Really, really, really impressive stuff. Looking good here. It's going to be... do we know the second map?
No, we don't know the second map just yet.
But it's going to be really interesting to see how they continue to adapt, because now they've got an idea of like, okay, this is how they're doing. These are some adjustments we can make. They are more than capable of taking a game or a series off of Tempo Storm.
Oh, most certainly. I mean, looking at most of those plays, I think the only drawbacks to a lot of their play was just Tempo Storm knowing exactly what their weaknesses were. But Evil Geniuses was adapting really quickly.
Yep.
Like, they were waiting. As soon as they saw the situation where their longboat raid was wasted and Tempo Storm just backed away, and then the next one, I mean, Idra waited for the perfect moment to use that longboat. It was a pretty good longboat. Unfortunately, the battle still didn't go in their way, but that's that little, like, mid-game adaptation. That's a very, very strong attribute of a good team. And I think with these pickups of Mad Timmy and who was the other one who...
Kothanlok.
And Kothanlok, yes. Kothanlok was doing so much damage that game.
He's good. He's very good with Vala, that's for sure.
I mean, looking at the takedowns right now, EG only had one takedown more in terms of just like looking over like the broad spectrum. I see a lot of fours and fives on EG on Tempo Storm. And EG has fours and threes, so it's just that one little bit could have possibly turned that game into their favor. So we're going to run to a quick commercial break, guys. We'll be right back with game number two. I am invigorated after watching that game. We'll be right back. Stay tuned.